Hey, this is The Lowdown with Lindsay Lohan. This is my chance to share with you all some amazing people, places, and things that are inspiring to me. I hope that each episode will challenge you, inspire you, and give me the chance to share more of my life with all of you. Welcome to The Lowdown. Today, I'm talking to the iconic Salt-N-Pepa. We're getting into what it was like to tour in the 80s, how they created their own fashion identity themselves, and learning to embrace being female icons. Well, hello. I'm Lindsay Lohan. Welcome to the Lowdown.
Hi.
Thank you so much for being here.
Absolutely.
Would you prefer I call you Salt-N-Pepa or should I do Cheryl and Sandra? What do you prefer?
Okay, so when
you call me Pep.
Oh, sorry. No, it's fine. What do you think you would want to call me?
I feel like you're Salt-N-Pepa to me.
Okay, so let's go with that. Let's go with Salt-N-Pepa.
All right, so everyone knows you as the dynamic duo of Salt-N-Pepa. Mm-hmm. How did you meet? How did that name come to fruition? Can you fill me in on a little bit of that?
Well, we met at Queensborough Community College in Queens. And Pep says she hates when I say community college. So we met.
Yeah.
We met in college. We could leave off the community. Queensborough College. Neither one of us was going to class. At least I wasn't. We were playing spades in the lunchroom because, like, I really didn't want to be there. And we also, I worked at Sears Roebuck as a telephone solicitor where I met my boyfriend, Herbie. And when I got to know Pep, I told her Herbie and I were, they were hiring at Sears and she was like, I want a job. And I was like, they'll hire anybody. You can come get a job. And we started working together. Our producer Herbie worked there. Kid and Play worked there. Martin Lawrence worked there. So it was a creative hotspot.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So we ended up making our first song with our producer Herbie, which was The Show. It was an answer to
Showstopper.
The Showstopper, an answer to Slick Rick and Dougie Fresh's The Show. And there you have it.
But then where did Salt-N-Pepa, the names, come from? Who thought of that first?
Well, you know what? In our first song, The Showstopper, you know, there's some lyrics in there in the verse. And we're like saying how we go together like Salt-N-Pepa.
I know.
And it's funny because our original name was Supernature.
Yeah.
And everybody, we always felt like, oh, that was just not us and are you too formal? And then when the fans used to say, play those Salt-N-Pepa girls, them Salt-N-Pepa girls. So, and Herbie was like, yeah, you're Salt, you're Pepper. And it just all went together and it works.
But did you, the two of you really opened the doors. You were such big feminists then in such a male dominated industry. Did you realize that through your music you were going to be able to reach other people, and that's why you started Let's Talk About Sex was one of my favorite songs. So
yeah,
how did you feel in at that time, you know, in such a male dominated industry, being such strong, powerful women, were opening the doors for so many people? How did that come to fruition?
Well, you know what? We weren't really thinking about any of that. You know, we were just following our passion. For me personally, when I got on the mic, it was like I came alive. Like for some reason, it gave me purpose. I was like, this is what I want to do. This is where I belong. And I had no plan B. And being in the industry with so many men and it being such a male-dominated field, we had situations we had to deal with, obviously. But like Pep said, we were so focused on our goal, on what we wanted to accomplish in the industry. And along the way, as we grew, our music grew, and we did end up doing Let's Talk About Sex, which in the beginning of the song, we said, they're not going to play this on the radio as a challenge. And they totally went for it and started playing the song. And it kind of opened up a conversation. Why is talking about sex so taboo? Isn't it important for us to talk about it? And we ended up doing Let's Talk About AIDS, because during that time, you know, nobody wanted to tackle that issue. And Salt-N-Pepa were one of the first ones to come out and be advocates and spread awareness for HIV and AIDS. And we made a PSA with Peter Jennings called Let's Talk About AIDS. So that's something that we're very proud of.
This was something else I wanted to ask you about. Are there some causes and issues now that you think need more attention brought to them? Do you think, because when you brought it up, it was people were actually listening and it's kind of died down a bit. Do you think there's more issues that people need to pay attention to?
Yeah, HIV and AIDS is one of them. There's still a lot of misinformation. Go ahead, Pat.
No, I was just advocating for women, having a voice, platforms. We've been associated with different, organizations throughout our career to this day, even St. Jude's, St. Jude's Hospital, for children. I just think it's just important that to have such a platform that we have and such a success, it is important to associate with all the important of different things that's going on in the world and advocate for it and be a voice for it. Because I think we have a responsibility, at least we do, because just to go a little bit back to the male dominated field, I think it also fuels us. It fueled us to stay strong because we were women and because we were facing so many challenges, and we were selling out musically arenas just as well as the men in the business. But we were, not as popular or in media.
You weren't looked at the same. Yeah.
Same way, right. Even in media back then, they'll interview this artist, the male artist over the female, us, on a top radio show or whatever. We were experiencing that, back then. And now it's, of course, it's great. It's more media and social media and the internet. And it's a beautiful thing. But yes, it was. We hear it too. And we understand it, how strong it is to stay true to yourself and know your worth. And just, even against all the adversity, to stay strong through it. Because it's not easy to know the good with the bad and try to understand it and take it and deal with it. If you gotta, if you're focused on your dream goals.
Yeah, I agree with that so much. I mean, it's, you have to also, like, the people you surround yourself. You're both so lucky because you have each other to kind of stand by each other, which is the best part of it. But that's, I mean, what was it like touring back, like, in the 80s and early 90s? What was touring like for you? What was...
Touring was fun. It was more fun.
I've never toured. I've only visited people that are, at a concert backstage. So tell me about it, because it's so exciting to me.
Well, touring was a lot of fun back then. I mean, when we were all like a family, Kid and Play and Heavy D and the boys, sometimes we would share a bus. We didn't have the budget to have two buses, and we would share a bus, and we would party and play tricks on each other and just make the best of the road, because the road can be really lonely, especially for a woman. Like, men, every night there's a new girl in their room. Like, we ain't taking guys to our room every night, So we're living out of a suitcase. We don't have our stuff, at home the way we normally would. If you got a boyfriend at home, you're like pining away for your boyfriend. So you find ways to keep yourself going and to keep having fun. So especially in the 90s, it was so much fun going on the road.
And now, because we have our, a tour coming out, Kids on the Block. So skip to our tour bus now, and we have two now.
So you each have your own?
Yes.
Yeah.
But that might not be as much fun then, because you don't have each other like all the time.
No, that's a good thing.
She likes her break.
Look at me. See? Cutting your budget to give you one tour bus. Who do I think I am?
No, she likes that break. She likes the little interval space between me and her. But I'm gonna hop on her bus, trust me, Lindsay. Where are you? Where are you based?
Well, so right now I'm in San Francisco, but I'm based in Dubai.
Oh, nice. That's
but so I've been living there for about 7 years, which is so different. It's wild,
Wow.
I love it. I am actually going there for my birthday this
when
year.
When is your birthday?
November 9th.
Oh my, well, I'll be there.
Okay, so gotta see each other then.
Oh my God, yes. It's so exciting. When people come to visit Dubai, I get so excited because I'm like, oh my God, we have to hang out. We have to do something. We gotta get together.
So how'd you end up in Dubai as your base? Long story.
I was gonna ask you something about this, because being such, especially the two of you being such role models for people to look up to and admire, it becomes, you forget to take time for yourself. Mm. And I think a lot of my life was that. It was always just my downtime was spent going out with people and trying to just feel like I was in living a normal college life. Mm-hmm. And so I hit that wall where I was just like, I need to just start fresh, mm-hmm. just for my own sanity. Wow. And just go to a place that's a bit more serene, mm-hmm. and just, you know, flip that switch. Mm-hmm. And it really worked for me. I don't know if it would work for everyone, but for me, it really did. I miss New York a lot. I mean, whenever I'm in the States, I end my trip in New York or start it there because my family's all there.
Yeah. That's a big, brave move. Way to like really switch your life around.
I just kind of did it.
Yeah. Good for you.
It's
but it's hard. I was going to ask, like, how do you feel, especially even now you're going on tour again. And when you were at your time, how was it for you to be role models to people? I mean, did you feel the pressure then?
Yes, absolutely. You can totally relate to you just trying to live your life and being in the public eye, and everything you do or say is being scrutinized. And then also just naturally, you know, becoming a mom was a big deal for us, I think, and for me personally. Mm-hmm. We started thinking,
I can relate to that because I'm hitting that kind of time now,
where
it's like you almost have to choose when you're gonna work, like it's mm-hmm. almost you have to kind of separate everything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And when you're young, you kind of really just roll with the punches, you know. I don't think you're totally aware of like how difficult it is, but when you look back, and you know, I was pregnant in the Let's Talk About Sex video. Pep was pregnant in the Expression video. We took our kids on the road as much as we could. You know, they were missing us. We were missing them. But we just kept pushing it, you know? Like, we just had to keep going. But when you look back, it's like, really? We really did a lot, accomplished a lot as mothers, as career women, and as artists.
And you know what it is, though? It is a fine line of the pressure, though, because here we are young and we were speaking in our truth and in our truth and we're, you know, how we feel. But here we're coming, these strong women, and, you know, other women are going, oh, my God, I totally get them. I can listen to them. And then our fan base is growing. And we didn't start out as role models. You know, we like two chicks, you know, in Queens. And like I said, the streets having fun. It was a different time. And here we had to get all polished up because people were looking up to us. And then our audience started changing. We're younger, you know, kids was coming. Mothers was bringing their children. And it was like, I remember I used to curse really loud in the cut. And I used to be like, I was like, I have to change that. I see this little girl in the front, like, I'm like, oh, what you doing here? Now I gotta change my curse control around.
You're like worried. You're like, because you don't want your daughter to see that or your kids.
Yeah, I have a little mouth, man.
But kids are so much older now. I mean, I don't know how you feel about this, but I'm not tech savvy. So when it comes to I can maybe take a picture and then post it on Instagram. But when it comes to all the other stuff, like TikTok and everything, I just cannot do it. I'm terrified because I am that person that will think I'm doing the right thing and just it will go completely wrong. I'll just screw it all up.
I agree.
I didn't mean it like that.
I go through the same thing. My daughter will call me and be like, Mom, take that down. Either it's a blurry picture or bad grammar, or I said something. She's like, they're going to come down on you if you don't take that down. it makes me like, I don't want to post at all. I question every post.
Yeah. Because it's not even fun. Even Instagram was fun in the beginning. It was more casual. Yeah. But now it's like a job.
It is a whole job.
It is a job. I don't want to do it. It's like, God, like I just had a picture the other day. And I know my makeup artist. It's natural. I was turning. Yes, it's natural to turn it in this wrinkle. Of course it's natural. But the world ain't going to say it's natural. Yeah. They're gonna go, look at Pep's neck. Oh, she hitting them ages. Look at her. I'm like,
I posted picture one day and I was sitting, and when I crossed my legs, like my cellulite like really is pronounced. And I looked at the picture and I was like, you know what? I'm a grown woman. Who cares? Women have cellulite. Get over it. Girl, I posted that picture. It was all about the cellulite on my legs, all the comments. And I was like, should I take it down? But I left it up. I don't care. We're human. It is what it is. Yeah. And I don't believe in airbrushing, like, so extreme. Like, a little, you know, filter, but that like everyone's looking like robots right now on social
media. Yeah, everyone looks the same. It's scary.
Yeah, it's very scary.
And everyone's always done up. You feel like if you're more casual, no one's going to accept you almost.
Yeah. And they're just going to trash you. It's a lot of pressure for this generation.
That's why sorry to keep it going, but that's why you see a lot of the IG, like these challenges, it's going from plain to beautiful or something, you know, you're done up. This is this, and then this is me. You know, it's not the opposite, like kind of like on that. So it's to a sense to keep up a little, you know.
And with
well, there's the no pressure. Room to, there's no room for normal. We're going further away from normalcy.
Yeah.
Really.
We're going to be living in the metaverse. We're just going to all be like, like,
you better figure that out, what the metaverse is.
Lindsay, look at you, girl. You look fabulous, girl.
You're going to be touring in the metaverse.
They are touring. Starting, it's happening. They're starting to tour in the metaverse. It's crazy.
Wait, what's that?
Oh, girl, no. We can't explain the metaverse now. No. Nope, we ain't got time. I'll explain it to you later.
I'm about to Google that whole thing. Metaverse.
Yes, yes.
Have you
that
even
sounds
tried?
Sci-fi-ish it to me.
It is.
It is.
Oh, okay. You know I'm into that. I love that.
Have you tried any of the visual goggles that you wear where you're in the game?
Yes, yes. OMG, yes.
I tried it once and I tried, I think I was doing like a Star Wars lightsaber thing and I almost like fell into a Christmas tree, hit my friend's kid with a fake saber.
Oh, no.
And you're sweating to death because you're really moving in it.
See, that's the part I don't understand because I've never tried it, but I always look at the TikToks where they're doing it and I'm like, well, what's to stop that guy from running over the balcony? Like, I mean, it seems really dangerous because you're like, you don't know where you are. You could not.
You're just going.
It's like that.
I don't understand that. You could get hurt. You could fall. Like, I know I would totally fall into a wall or something. It's a lot.
Yeah. You'd find me unconscious. Because it becomes addictive. You want to win the game. You're stuck there.
And you're getting
really
exercise
creepy.
At the same time.
Yeah.
Right?
That's good. But
that's good.
Maybe you need to do it like in a boxing ring or a padded room.
Yeah.
Yes. I think so. Yes.
Really look crazy.
They say she's serious about this game.
Build a
I'm not trying to get hurt. Thank you.
But fashion wise, like I look at what's going on now, like for art, current artists, you know, we all love a glam team, right? I wish I could walk around with one. When we started, there was none of that. We did our own makeup. We did our own hair in the beginning. We shopped for our own clothes, like that iconic Salt-N-Pepa picture where we have one of the 8-ball jackets for Push It and the spandex with the kente hat. Like we put that look together. And so I feel like Salt-N-Pepa brought fun fashion and femininity into hip-hop in so many ways. We were bold enough to just be girls, you know, because it was a lot of misogyny in hip-hop. And a lot of girls were like wearing baggy clothes and kind of being hard. And we were just like, nope, that's not what we're going to do. We're going to be ourselves.
Yeah.
And I think everyone could relate to that authenticity.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah.
Do you think that, because... I personally feel now sometimes there's a line between sexy and too overtly sexy. Like it's either too little or too much that people are showing, which is so different.
I'm gonna let Salt answer this because my cat is trying to get out and she crazy right now.
I don't want
her to make noise. I'll come right back in.
Get the cat.
What a way to bow out of the difficult
avoid
questions.
The question.
That was real good, girl. Cat.
There is no cat.
There is no. You don't have any cats. How about that? But okay. So yeah. So I feel like, you know, during our time, there was such a variety of women in hip hop with different voices saying different things. Salt-N-Pepa, like we just discussed, fun fashion, femininity. Latifah was the queen, you know, she represented positivity and, you know, political issues. Then we have Lauryn Hill, who was like the consciousness to me of hip hop. Missy Elliott was the innovative one. You know, everyone was doing something different. I'm all for female empowerment, for sure, and for freedom of speech. And creativity and all that, I would never want to see anyone, you know, stifled. But I will say, that, you know, it has leaned very heavily in one direction. And I think that there's room for diversity. And the question is, you know, there was a long time where there were no women and everybody was like, where's the women? Where's the women? There was this big gap, right, between one era and another. And then Nikki came out and she led the charge, you know, and then all these women started going behind her. But from what I'm seeing, it's like there's only a certain type of, like you spoke about sexuality. It's like the more overtly sexual you are, the better. And that's kind of like becoming like a cookie cutter thing. And I know that there's other rappers out there, female rappers, that have other things they want to bring to the table. So I'm all for
more. And have a lot to say.
I'm just all for more diversity. And whoever's in charge of, you know, pushing people through, you know, because it was the record companies before, but now I don't know. It's
the individuals themselves, I think.
It's the individuals themselves. Well, it feels like there's a championing of the more sexual you are, the better. And it's almost to me like,
I mean, speaking about Instagram, you can't open it without seeing a bikini photo. And if you're not doing that, it almost feels like you're not worthy.
Yeah.
Which is,
So my fear for this generation is just, to me, it's like, is the message being put to them that this is their value, what they look like, their sexuality, what they have to offer physically. But then what about the rest of you?
I just think it's just a conditioning thing to, you know, what really also sells, in terms of sales. And some people put out certain songs, but you don't ever hear about it, you know. And it could be it's just conditioning of all too, like a lot of the male rappers of what they're talked about women and bash women and bitch women out and, you know, anything, the skeet skeet, but, you know, and so these women now with the voice now, it's like.
They want to flaunt it the way they want to.
They want to flaunt it. And you don't tell me how to flaunt myself.
Which is awesome.
Down. Which is awesome in that respect. But this kind of language, my mom used to listen to Millie Jackson back in the days, and she's have a song called, it was spelled P-H-U-C-K. But what is that pronounced? And I used to be young. I might have been 13. I used to be at hearing that, fuck you. And she used to sing that in the 70s. And I'm like, Ma. She's saying P-H-U-C-K. I said, Ma, that's still pronounced F-U-C-K. You up in here. But I was just saying, that's why it's great to just have platform, the diversity. And then there are people like the Salt-N-Pepa who takes the time and then, attaches themselves like others to projects because I think it's important to have a voice.
For people that don't have one.
Exactly.
Completely. Okay, I want to play a little game. It's called Lowdown and Dirty. it's not what you think it is. All right. If you could only watch one movie for the rest of your life, what would you be watching?
Salt-N-Pepa Lifetime biopic. I'd be like, damn.
Wow, there's too many great movies to ever really answer that question, honestly.
Could do too.
I'll tell you a movie that I, when I really want to relax my brain, I'll throw on The Color Purple.
Oh, that's a good one.
Yeah.
That's definitely a good one.
It calms me, that movie. You just get like trapped in it.
That's kind of what you go to for a movie. It's either funny to calm you or just really emotional for movies for me, or scary.
Yeah.
You like scary movies?
I do, but I can't watch them at night.
Oh.
I can't. Oh. If I fall asleep to watching a scary movie, then I'm going to have nightmares. And I yell in my nightmares.
Wow.
So it's not safe. Okay, the perfect meal consists of?
Ooh, the perfect plantains.
Ooh.
It'll be in there some kind of way. I love plantains. I'm just saying it's a nice, sweet,
what's
even
the rest
if I
of
do rice and peas.
What's the recipe?
Oh, with the plantain? Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. My gosh. So, like, you know, rice and peas and some curry chicken.
Oh.
Sounds good. I love Jamaican food, too. So I'm going to go with, when I was dating our producer, Herbie, he's Haitian. His mom, I used to be in his house, his mom a lot. His mom used to make a dish called lumbi. Remember, Sandy? It was a Haitian dish.
Yes, there were the rice and chicken.
With black Ooh. Rice. And some kind of conch, like a conch fish. And I never got to have that again. And I'm like, man, that was the best food ever. So a Jamaican lumbi.
Oh, yeah, that's funny.
You're going to have to try it, go there and then make it. Mm-hmm. All right, who was your musical hero growing up? Whoever wants to answer first. And what do you listen to now?
I mean, in terms of hip hop, of course, you know, in hip hop world, Run DMC, growing up, then was one of them for us because we always thought that we were like the female Run DMC before we even got our break. I grew up on their music, and then of course I'm reggae, so like Shaggy, you know, because you know, in my family, a lot of reggae music, a lot of different reggae artists, of course. But soul music, I don't know, it's a variety.
You can't
know,
pick one.
Okay, it's hard.
It's okay. It'll come to you.
So I need to pick one.
If you can.
If you can.
Because people will want to know.
One artist, one song, one grown one musical maybe. Artist.
Yeah.
My first concert I ever went to, I was fortunate enough to see Prince in concert, and that concert like I was a Prince fan, but I think I became like an actual real fan after I saw him in concert. So I'm gonna put Prince up there, and like Pep said, Run DMC, you know, we were the female Run DMC. They were from Queens, uh-huh. We were from Queens. So yeah, and then the era that really inspired me was Motown, pretty much. All Motown music, the Supremes, Smokey Robinson.
That's what I mean.
Marvin Gaye, like that whole, no.
Yeah.
That whole crew, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's what we grew up listening to. That's what our All parents right. were listening to, Motown.
Right.
It's so funny, Motown, because I was signed to Motown wow. after I left Casablanca Records, and I was a Sylvia Roan, and it was just,
wow. It
was like a transitional where they were trying to get me to do, kind of go hip hop, and I was like, this isn't going to work, guys, I'm more like rock, I'm more like pop rock, but you can try.
That's crazy, man.
But I did, I ended up doing a song with Snoop.
What? I didn't know that.
Called Walka Not a Talka. But when you mentioned Motown, I was a Sylvia Roan there. So it reminded me of that.
Oh, shoot. I got to listen to that. Imagine? I need to listen to that.
Yeah, you have to. Tell
I
me
definitely
what you think.
Have to. Not a walk. What is it? What's the
walk
name?
Walka Not a Talka.
Walka Not a Talka. Definitely.
Snoop
okay, what's
you
your
high?
Bucket list vacation? No.
Pep got high with Snoop. She never did it again.
We recorded at different times, actually.
Oh, yeah, I recorded at different times. Okay.
Yeah.
So what was the next question?
Okay, the next one. What's your bucket list vacation?
Lindsay, this is really hard.
Because you're going to need one after you're done touring.
Can I?
Go ahead.
I'm telling you, my two favorite places is Jamaica and Dubai.
Okay.
So you mean somewhere I've never been, right?
No, that can be it.
It's just, oh, yeah, that's my hands down, Jamaica and Dubai.
Yeah. I've never been to Jamaica.
You haven't?
I want to go. No.
Wow.
My brother went, we were supposed to go together once, and then I ended up getting snowed in New York. I couldn't go, and he went without me. So him and his wife went, but I didn't get to go.
Wow.
Good.
For me, I think we have never been to Greece, and I see pictures of Mykonos, and I'm like, I think that's where I was.
Greece is pretty and it's fun. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's also good if you want to bring your kids, like it's good for everything, for like family and just to go alone. Everyone can have something to do.
Yeah. Or yeah, if, I heard it's if beautiful. That like you know how people will take a boat, a yacht, and they'll like just go from cruise. Country, not a cruise. No, girl, I hate cruises.
No, I mean, they just cruise on the yacht.
What's your dream? Yeah. What's your dream vacation?
I'm not trying to put you on a cruise.
Oh, God.
Carnival cruises.
Carnival cruises. No. A yacht, somebody's yacht. I want to travel from country to country on someone's yacht for like a month.
Like Italy, like that would be Greece. Great.
Like we, when yeah. we perform with Sardinia.
That is the dream. Go, that is the dream vacation, yes. actually.
Yeah. French Riviera.
Yeah. yeah. That's the best dream vacation.
You've done that.
Anyone could ask
You've
for.
You've done that, Lindsay. Right?
No, I went once with my sister for a few days in Italy. Mm-hmm. It was just the two of us.
Nice.
And it was honestly the best time I've ever had with her in my life. And just in general, like just to spend that time together and experience. Like we mm-hmm. stopped in Stromboli in these little places you wouldn't even think of. And it was just really beautiful. I almost lost her once. And then found her. But it was just a really... I always, you know, it's always important when you take time and like to go on a trip with a friend or a family member. It's just the best feeling.
And be present, like for real. Yeah.
yeah.
And that was your sister. yeah. She said to be present.
I think she wanted to be lost for a little. And so then she decided when she wanted me to find her. All right. I'm not going to keep you forever because I know you're both busy. But is there lastly anything you want to tell the world and plug away, anything you want to say or?
Okay.
Well, you
just want to.
Go ahead.
Mm-hmm. No, go ahead.
This is a delay. I think we have a little delay.
Does this happen a lot with the two of you? No, you go. No, you go. No, you go. No, wait.
First of all, yeah, obviously the mixtape tour is coming up. We're really excited. That starts in Cincinnati on May 10th. What I want to say to the world, I guess, you know, since we have always had worldwide success and a lot of support, thank you for loving us and keeping us, like Pep always says this at the end of every show, so relevant and so alive.
So alive.
For 36 years.
Yes.
I feel like I was just at a show.
I did not.
Just fangirled out.
Yes. Yes. It's a great feeling.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you so much, both of you. Thank you.
Thank you.
And I'm coming to see you on your tour for sure. I'm coming.
Okay.
I'm coming. I'm going to catch you. Yeah. When will you be in New York?
Not sure. We'll let
you
know.
We're going to get that to you. For sure.
Okay. All right. All right. Lots of love. God bless you.
God bless you. God bless you.
That was such a fun conversation. It was literally a backstage pass into their lives. I mean, who would have thought I would have got to ask Salt-N-Pepa what their favorite food was, their favorite vacation destinations, and so much more. I'm definitely going to be going to see them on tour.